Treat. Thanks to Professor Kiming Liu, who received a diversity grant at Medgar Evers College from the City University of New York, we are able to sponsor this guest lecture. And this lecture is dedicated to Professor Betty Lee Song, who I believe is celebrating her 80th birthday today. So I would like to ask Professor Kiming Liu to come up here and then introduce the speaker.
Thank you.
Please welcome Professor Kiming Liu. Ready? Hold this and then put it up.
Okay, all right. So hope it goes well. Hello, good evening. Thank you for coming to Professor Weiner's lecture or talk or whatever you name it. Okay. My name is Kiming Liu. I recently received a grant from CUNY for a project I'm working on, which is tentatively or momentarily, I don't know if I will change the title, Asian voices in the diaspora. And today's lecture would be the first one in the series, if I can get other good speakers like Professor Weiner. But in short, I came to know Professor Michael Weiner when I was a fellow of Japanese studies last June in San Diego. And Professor Weiner is the director of the Japan Studies Institute, which sponsors or grants fellowship to professors in colleges and universities throughout the country to study Japanese history, religion, and so on and so forth. Spend a month in the very good weather, California. So I had the opportunity to be there. And Professor Weiner is currently the chairperson of Modern Japanese History, no, Department of Asian Pacific Studies at San Diego University. And Professor Weiner is not from California. And you were born on the East Coast, correct? And then went to London. And Professor Weiner was professor at the University of Sheffield and in England, and visiting professor at the University of Massachusetts in the early 90s, and at Dartmouth College in the mid-90s. Then, in 1985, that's before, Professor Weiner was at Hokkaido. My Japanese is not as good as I thought it would be. University. Mm-hmm. And Hosei University. Anything else? Yes, Professor Weiner is a very prolific writer as well. He has published many articles and books. Among them are The Origins of Korean Community in Japan and Japan's Minorities, The Illusion of Homogeneity, and Japan, Race and Identity. Without much ado, I would like to welcome Professor Weiner, who landed from the West Coast on the East Coast last night and dread the weather here. And I don't blame him, but here's Professor Weiner.
No, I've got a loud mouth.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
But they need to...
Unless you want to clip it.
No.
Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Kiming referred to the fact that San Diego has wonderful weather. This is true, except in June. June is notorious for its gloom, so I suppose in a way this is her revenge on me. I'm having to experience an East Coast winter at least for 3 or 4 days, and it's really pretty frightening. Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. I am delighted to be here. And I'll be talking about a number of things over the next 45 minutes or so, after which you're welcome to engage me in questions, throw bottles at me, or whatever you prefer. I'll be looking at two issues, or three issues in particular. One is the relevance of historical revisionism in contemporary Japan, and its impact, the second part, on the politics of identity, or one could also phrase it as culture wars in Japan over what it means to be Japanese and what is the meaning of Japaneseness. And the third area is to look at briefly those populations, those groups in Japan who have by and large been excluded, marginalized from orthodox narratives of identity and history in modern Japan. So I'll start. Identity politics increasingly permeates popular and political discourse in Japan. There is something of a standard script, and even a standard narrator, usually a conservative academic, diet member, cabinet minister, or journalist. And all of these people deplore what they regard as the corrosion of traditional values and norms of behavior. And they also rail against the apparent dictatorship of what they call the periphery. Pundits and politicians alike denounce the challenge set by dissonant historical narratives, while news magazines and cartoons, manga in particular, appeal to populist sentiment in Japan through a rewriting of recent and not so recent history. Symbolic of this trend has been the Association for History Textbook Reform, whose doyen, or spiritual leader, Fujioka Nobukatsu, has argued explicitly that the mission of cultural institutions is to transmit an undiluted Japanese heritage and to restore what he has defined as a distinctive Japanese historical consciousness. Within this discourse or argument, false histories, like those of the Comfort Women, Unit 774, which conducted biological experimentation against Chinese and Allied prisoners of war, the ill treatment of prisoners of war during the Pacific War, simply did not take place. They could not have taken place because the Imperial Japanese Army was not capable of crimes against humanity. A subtext that resonates throughout the arguments put forward by Fujioka and others is that in the not-so-distant past, an incontestable, an unchallenged, and deserved consensus reigned concerning the integrity and virtue of a homogeneous Japanese civilization. From this perspective, the centerpiece of this timeless edifice, which of course supersedes history, is under threat. What frightens these self-appointed custodians of the soul of Japan is the flimsiness of a now porous culture, where everything is in motion, where public confidence in once hallowed institutions has been eroded, where marginality is no longer quite so marginal, and where the fragments of identity are on sale everywhere. Today, in Japan, these currents are at work almost everywhere to one degree or another. Jets transport immigrants from Sao Paulo to Tokyo, while back in Sao Paulo, engineers clone computers that will assist in the instantaneous flow of capital, ideas, and culture between Tokyo, New York, and London. Vast neon-lit billboards that dominate the entertainment districts of Tokyo, Osaka, and other Japanese cities offer an African-American inspired future to young Japanese. But at the same time, political elites and academic pundits in Japan seek refuge from multiculturalism in racialized stereotypes of minority populations in Japan and elsewhere. The Japanese resident of Ikebukuro, a northern suburb of Tokyo, has never spoken with his third-generation Zainichi Korean neighbor, whose children attend an ethnic Korean school and who employs Brazilian Nikkei gene in his factory. These actors seem only aware of one another at points of friction over education, employment, housing, and of course, identity. These collisions are widely reported, filmed, and videotaped. They have become lore, and over time, they too will congeal into history. These centrifugal forces and the collisions that they bring about feel all the more intense in Japan today as a result of national economic decline and demographic realignment. The paradox for the Japanese today is that as the circulation of capital, ideas, images, and knowledges become increasingly global, the reality that people experience, the one that brings a sense of comfort, community, belonging, and membership, becomes ever more stubbornly local. In this global backwash, people seek a protective enclosure, one that will differentiate them from the mass into which they feel they might otherwise disappear. The solidarity they trust is the one closest to hand, the one defined by people who look and speak like themselves. And here lies the promise of historical revisionism and identity politics. The key to their undoubted success lies not in the logical persuasiveness of a particular position, but in an ability to exploit fears of isolation and to speak, or to pretend to speak, on behalf of normal Japanese. For these purveyors of Japanese purity, who also seek to rewrite history and to reinvent a distinctive Japanese identity, a porous society is an impure society. And their impulse is to purge society of its impurities, to wall off the stranger, to rearrange history, and to reaffirm common sense understandings of Japan as a homogeneous and monocultural society and polity. But the construction and maintenance of national identity and culture in Japan have always been precarious projects, constantly seeking to reproduce a sense of uniformity and organic integrity from inherent incoherence. Although revisionists like Fujioka, Nishio Kanji, and Kobayashi Yoshinori would have us believe otherwise, the historical record clearly suggests that the Japanese people have never been entirely at ease with the rhythms imposed by an orthodox identity. On the contrary, and it's worth thinking about this, their apparent fascination with the mirrors of culture and the extent to which the Japanese have inspected, classified, and reclassified themselves all suggests the absence rather than the presence of a cohesive identity to which all could faithfully subscribe. Increasing pressure for the construction of a multicultural Japan, as well as resistance to these demands, requires an analysis that goes beyond the immediate, in other words, beyond the present. In other words, the issue or issues may not be what they seem. The struggle for national culture and identity in Japan has far deeper sources than the partisans on either side seem prepared to recognize. Some are relatively recent in origin. A decade-long economic crisis that has eroded confidence in state and public institutions. Structural dependence on the types of labor provided by foreign workers. Declining birth rates and a rapidly aging society. But others go deeper still. The demographic, political, and economic dislocations that have accompanied the rapid, I say rapid, 120-year transformation of Japan from peripheral state on the edge of Asia to metropolitan state. In addition, we also have to take into account long-running debates concerning the national self, a race scientific or eugenist system of population control, and the systematic subjugation and exploitation of minority populations. There is a lineage to these anxieties, for the Japanese have frequently worried about where their essence lies. Throughout post-restoration, that is to say post-1868 history, political ideologues, scientists, social scientists, educators, and journalists in Japan have periodically attempted to erect boundaries of inclusion and exclusion, defining and redefining the pure Japanese self on the basis of blood, or culture, or language, or all of the above, and all with the assumption that these are immutable, inherent, and unchanging characteristics. During the 1930s, this preoccupation was reflected in the work of Nishida Kitaro and Watsuji Tetsuro and others associated with what was known as the Kyoto School. In the contemporary context, the Nichibunken, or the International Center for Research on Japanese Culture, which is one of the most, perhaps the best endowed research center on the globe. This research center has undertaken a national mission. It has its objectives have been defined by the central government. It's a mission of articulating and propagating a distinctive Japanese cultural identity. Such projects suggest, at least to me, that historically, the Japanese have been and remain fearful that on the whole, a sense of nationness, of oneness, a unity of values and purpose did not and does not really exist. Or if it did or does, it was not destined to last very long. These concerns have at certain periods in modern Japanese history been incorporated within a social policy framework linking ideologies of race on the one hand with the pseudoscience of eugenics. A state commitment to the improvement of the body politic first emerged as early as the 1870s, that is to say within the first decade after the modern transformation actually began. Initial preoccupations were reflected in the creation of elaborate and powerful instruments for the compilation of data. And this data subsequently formed the basis for social policy in the areas of public hygiene and sanitation, gender relations, reproduction, and sexuality. During the empire-building decades, that is to say between the 1890s and 1945, notions of blood purity were invoked by educators and politicians alike, not only as a metaphor for shared heredity and ancestry, but as the essential stuff of race and national identity. By the early part of the 20th century, a specific field of modern scientific inquiry, eugenics, had permeated many aspects of daily existence. In fact, Japan was the first non-European state to establish a national eugenics society. And within a public discourse of modernization, the eugenics project was premised upon the construction of an organically defined nation state whose people could be physically and intellectually molded through conformity with new scientific disciplines. For those involved in the formulation of social policy, both at home and in the colonies, eugenics provided a modern means of understanding or conceptualizing social issues, social problems, in biological terms. In other words, people behaved the way they did based upon biological assumptions. But despite these attempts to compress what it meant or what it means to be Japanese into a single idea or set of exclusionary or exclusivist metaphors, divisions of class, gender, sexuality, region, and even national origin have provided a persuasive case for diversity and heterogeneity in Japan. The idea of a homogeneous Japan has therefore been ideological, because its constituent parts have repeatedly clashed politically, economically, and socially. But from its inception, and for the next 130 years, the Japanese nation-state has done its best to obscure or to hide these fault lines. In an effort to compress differences into a single set of national traits, the Japanese have been constructed as robust, courageous, childlike, devoted to the work ethic, committed to family, loyal, sensitive, and bound by shared cultural and physical or physiological origins. Although this core encompasses contradictory elements, these assumed characteristics have been affirmed, have been transmitted, propagated through multiple channels as inherent, products of a timeless and racial imperative, and superior, particularly in relation to the other peoples of Asia, superior in both lineage and content. While national identity has never been fixed or immobile for long, there have been periods of greater or lesser firmness. By and large, these have been congruent, in other words, they have paralleled Japan's status as a global actor. During the late 19th century and early part of the 20th century, the incorporation of territories to the north, Hokkaido, to the south, Okinawa, and to the west, Korea, reinforced notions of Japanese exceptionalism and, of course, the responsibilities this entailed. To be Japanese was to be implicated in the idea of frontier, very much in an American sense, that notion of the frontier, exploring a terra nullis that is uninhabited, though, of course, we know in the case of the United States that the West was inhabited. It was for the Japanese of that generation a promise that they could hold a share in a bold new project, to partake of the struggle in which civilization slowly but steadily liberated lesser peoples from barbarism and backwardness. But at the same time, awareness of assumed differences and the determination to preserve an imagined homogeneous core population also fueled a determination to police deviance, be it racial, ideological, or social. As a consequence, minority populations, be they indigenous, in the case of the Burakumin, or drawn from the colonial or post-colonial periphery, and this would include Ainu, Okinawans, Chinese, and Koreans. These groups have been historically excluded from the mainstream, including mainstream history. Limited, in fact, if not in law, these despised others, however codified, have had to make their homes along the margins of a world from which they have been excluded. Now, my intention thus far has been to sort of provide an introduction or an approach to an understanding of how certain symbolic melodramas have emerged and what these distortions reveal and conceal about perennial dilemmas of Japanese identity. In other words, periodic attempts dating from the Meiji period, 1868 to 1912, have been made consciously to project cultural and racial homogeneity as the foundations of national life in Japan. Powerful but selective cultural empathies have been mobilized, regional identities and languages suppressed, particular characteristics projected as inherent, and the meaning of Japaneseness recast in images of the enduring purity and homogeneity of the nation, the family, and the Japanese way of life. Defeat in the Pacific War and the seven-year occupation of the United by the United States between 1945 and 1952 released long-suppressed voices of dissent, and narratives of class and gender again challenged the existing orthodox interpretation of Japanese-ness. But a period of more or less uninterrupted economic growth, itself a consequence of Japan's Cold War alliance with the United States, offered a quick yet compelling answer to the perennial predicament of identity. Pockets of poverty remained in Japan, but almost everyone by the 1970s seemed to be, or at least thought of themselves as, members of a burgeoning and expanding and healthy middle class. In the course of only a few short years, less than two decades, a new basis for national identity, or at least a reworking of the past in the interest of a corporate present, had emerged. Work hard, consume well, marry properly, and stay out of trouble. Television, in particular, while certifying a high consumption way of life, that is to say, consumerism, it also served as an instrument for the naturalization of culture. By the end of the 1980s, to be Japanese meant the ability to acquire things, almost anything, anywhere, and at any price. If the Japanese urbanite, urban dweller in Tokyo or Osaka, lacked a sense of connectedness with an idealized rural past, consumer Japan offered a solution. A weekend of furusato, a weekend spent in the countryside living with a Japanese farm family. Anything was available at a price. This involved paying for a helicopter. This new identity, safely underpinned by an elusive but equally pervasive set of so-called Asian values, was by no means force-fed to an unwilling population. It was by and large welcomed as an explanation of what it meant to be Japanese, not always with enthusiasm, but at least with a sense of inevitability. Foreign scholars, politicians, and journalists, mainly European and North Americans, have also assisted in this process. In other words, the construction of an exclusive, exclusionist, and unique Japan. Early Japan experts, and here we go back to the 19th century again, early Japan experts, many of whom never bothered to learn the language, the Japanese language, contributed to the spread of stereotypical conceptualizations or visions of the Japanese. Constant repetition alone seems to have given their views wide currency. And gradually, the view that things Japanese were diametrically opposed to those of an equally homogeneous West came to be regarded as received wisdom. From as early as the 16th century, observers have often characterized Japan as a land of paradoxes and anomalies, exoticizing it as either a comical fantasy land, which need not be taken seriously, or, through the lens of far more menacing stereotypes later associated with notions of the yellow pearl. There was a book written in 1905 entitled The Valor of Ignorance, written by a retired U.S. Army general. His name was Homer Lea, 1905. And in this book, he predicted a race war between the yellow peoples and the white peoples, that the yellow people would be led by the Japanese, who were superior to all other yellow peoples, in a massive attack, a massive assault upon Western civilization. Samuel Huntington probably has taken a few has been inspired by this. But what's important to recognize is, okay, we say, well, 1905, that's a long time ago. The book was reprinted as recently as 1979 and can be purchased from Amazon.com. When Japanese capital seemed to threaten the Euro-American Global Alliance or Global Order during the 1980s, echoes of a resurgent, though somewhat refigured, Orientalism were apparent in books like The Japanese Brain, Japan as Number One, and The Enigma of Japanese Power. With very few exceptions, early post-war scholarship outside of Japan also failed to problematize the monolithic imagined Japan, that homogeneous Japan. On the contrary, a vast literature emerged that actually enhanced notions or ideas of Japanese uniqueness by privileging certain aspects of traditional culture as the source or wellspring of modernity and economic development. Within the bipolar dynamic of Cold War competition, scholars, particularly in the United States, sought to create or construct a group-oriented and communally based Japan as a capitalist alternative to Soviet-style socialism. In their haste, in their hurry to explain Japanese successes, relatively little attention was given to either the social costs associated with economic development or to the existence of an underclass in Japan, populated largely by members of minority populations. Indeed, it was not until the 1960s that the first foreign language studies of Japan's minorities appeared. Since then, and particularly since the 1980s, the literature in this area too has also expanded dramatically. Unsurprisingly, at least to me, the emergence of these alternative approaches to Japanese identity, Japanese culture, and Japanese society have accompanied both Japan's rise as a global economic actor and the transformation of the political economy of the Asia-Pacific region. A deepening engagement with neighboring states in Asia has not only raised questions about orthodox ideas concerning Japaneseness, but has also brought about a much higher degree of international scrutiny to issues of human rights, citizenship, and even history in Japan. Further impetus was provided by the politicization of minority struggles in Japan during the 1970s and 1980s, and of course, what was known as the Kokusaika boom, or internationalization boom in Japan. And much of this more recent research has been directed towards recovering, uncovering the voices of those silenced by patriarchy, colonial rule, and the incomplete decolonization of Hokkaido and Okinawa in particular. But the spread or diffusion of alternative frameworks for understanding Japan also rejuvenated their opposite, most infamously in the form of former Prime Minister Nakasone Yasuhiro's infamous remarks in 1986, in which he reasserted claims to Japanese purity and homogeneity as fundamental to the creation of an information society. And he compared this to the United States, where the existence of large minority populations would prevent the creation of an information state, information society. Nakasone's reiteration of the myth of the monoracial nation state in Japan needs also to be considered as a reaction to what he and other revisionist politicians and historians perceived then as the evils of multiculturalism. It is only 3 years since, and this is now from now, so 2001, it is only 3 years since Ishihara Shintaro the current governor of Tokyo Prefecture, and a potential future prime minister raised fears in a press announcement, raised fears of a foreign insurrection on the streets of the capital, and wondered aloud whether the Japanese military had sufficient strength to suppress such an insurrection. Alarmist demagoguery of this type was eerily reminiscent of that which precipitated the massacre of thousands of Koreans in September 1923 on the streets of Tokyo, Yokohama, and Kawasaki. Even more recent than that, this is July 2003, Eto Takami, former minister of construction in Japan and a current faction leader within the ruling Liberal Democratic Party, went on record and dismissed the rape of Nanking as a, and I quote, a historical fabrication, justified the annexation of Korea in 1910 as a United Nations, that's capital U, capital N, sponsored operation, this is 1910, and condemned illegal immigrants in contemporary Japan as, and I quote again, degenerates who do nothing but steal and murder. Proponents of a pure Japan, like Ishihara, like Eto, like Nakasone, confront a world in flux. And like King Canute, they command it to stop. But because the flux is not going to stop, neither will the debates on history or multiculturalism. This shifting terrain is also reflected in alternative approaches to the study of race, ethnicity, and culture in modern Japan. And the same can be said of studies that focus on either the history of or contemporary status of minority populations in Japan. And this is because, at least in my view, an analysis of the construction, the creation of racial, ethnic, national, and cultural realities in modern Japan will also challenge the myth of a monocultural Japan. And this, of course, is central to the revisionist project. And by doing so, it also offers us alternative theoretical approaches to understanding majority-minority relations in modern Japan. And this draws our attention to, for example, historical relations between the Ainu of Hokkaido and the Wajin, which is the Ainu term for the mainland Japanese population. The colonization of Hokkaido, subsequent attempts to assimilate the Ainu as members of a subordinate race, Ainu resistance to this subjugation, and more recently, ethnic tourism in Hokkaido as a means of rejuvenating, restoring, or even reinventing an Ainu identity. Although indigenous to Hokkaido, the Ainu, like their counterparts in Okinawa, can perhaps best be understood as the subjects of internal colonization. Neither Hokkaido nor Okinawa were formally incorporated within the Japanese state until the latter half of the 19th century, and both continue to suffer the consequences of colonization. It was not, for example, until 1997 that the Ainu Cultural Promotion Act was introduced and replaced the colonialist Former Aborigines Protection Act of 1899. So in other words, for a century after 1899, the Ainu, although Japanese citizens, were regarded as aboriginals. Unlike other minority groups in Japan, the Burakumin are, in a classical sense, an indigenous population. Though unknown by many Japanese in contemporary Japan, they number nearly 3 million. Although common sense understandings have at times ascribed a foreign origin to the Burakumin, in particular that they came from Korea, the ideological and class position assigned to the Burakumin for more than 400 years underscore their Japanese origins. By contrast, the Zainichi, or Korean communities, are the most numerous of the foreign populations in Japan. And I refer to communities here, in terms of Koreans, as a reflection of the political and generational differences within that community, as well as distinguishing between relatively recent immigrants and those whose origins can be found before the colonial period. In other words, Korean communities have always existed in Japan. Korean communities have existed in Japan before either Korea or Japan, in fact, existed. Defined by many of the same pejorative or negative characteristics assigned to minority populations in the United States and elsewhere, the Korean community serves as a preeminent example of racialization in the absence of the color stigmata. Whether articulated by academics or politicians, this new reassertion of a pure Japanese self has a particular resonance for the Ainu, the Koreans, and other minority populations in Japan whose histories have been shaped by previous attempts to realize pure Japaneseness. Despite the collapse of the bubble economy, Japan continues to suck in labor from the global marketplace, principally from South and Southeast Asia, but also from as far afield as the Middle East, Africa, Eastern Europe, and Latin America. Central to the ongoing policy debate on immigration and nationality in Japan has been a single attempt, and that attempt has been to reconcile what has clearly become a structural demand for certain types of labor, a rapidly aging society, and negative birth rates on the one hand, with an ideological commitment to the preservation of a homogeneous polity, which of course has been espoused by conservative and revisionist politicians, academics, and journalists on the other hand. The 1990 revision of the Japanese Immigration and Refugee Control Act that resulted from this apparent impasse was intended to address the former, that is to say, address the need for certain types of labor, while at the same time maintaining the integrity of the latter. In other words, find a way to bring labor in from external sources while at the same time maintaining, at least in my terms, the fiction of a homogeneous Japan. Current, that is to say 2004, immigration laws have therefore structurally determined the relationship between class, culture, and race. And they have, by so doing, have enabled the transformation of presumed physical and blood similarities or differences among certain groups into the labor market and social stratification. In other words, the legal framework for immigration in Japan today has institutionalized racial and cultural difference through the progressive exclusion of immigrants and migrant workers from the Middle East, South Asia, and Southeast Asia on the basis of fears of social, cultural, and even physical contamination. The privileging of foreign nationals of Japanese descent under the law, on the other hand, has eased the entry of tens of thousands of Latin American Nikkeijin, whose assimilation, it was assumed, would be facilitated by cultural and racial affinities with the mainland Japanese population. Now, Nikkeijin is a term simply to refer to a foreign national who is of Japanese descent. And the intention was, as I've just stated, that tens of thousands of people of Japanese descent would migrate to Japan, fulfill these necessary labor niches in Japan, particularly in areas that the Japanese no longer wish to work in, the entertainment industry, construction, nursing, care for the elderly, and so on. But the assumption underlying this policy was really quite explicit. It was based on the assumption that people of Japanese descent, down to the third generation, would be Japanese. Because Japaneseness is a reflection of, is a function of, blood and inherited qualities. Now, of course, the Japanese American community would qualify for this, but there were relatively few amongst the young Japanese American community who were prepared to fly to Tokyo and take a job up flipping burgers in McDonald's. If they wanted to do that, they could do it here. Right? Where this had a particular attraction, however, was in Latin America, and in particular, Brazil, which is home to the largest Japanese descent population in the world. It is four times the size of the Japanese American community. Like labor migrants elsewhere, the Nikkei gene from Brazil, but also from Paraguay and Peru, but the numbers are much smaller, went to Japan to work. Their assumption was very instrumental. What caught the Japanese in Japan by surprise, particularly the government and employers, was that these people weren't Japanese. They didn't speak Japanese. They couldn't read Japanese. Most of them didn't like Japanese food. Their first language was Portuguese. They had no interest whatsoever in Japanese baseball. What they wanted to know about were the latest soccer scores from Brazil, or how the Brazilian national team had performed in the World Cup. I ran a three-year research project in Japan, interviewing employers, employees, many of whom were Nikkei-gene or employed Nikkei-gene. And almost without exception, employers said the same thing to me. We don't want these people. They're not Japanese. They're Latin Americans. All they want to do is siesta and fiesta. Please send back the Bangladeshis, the Pakistanis, the Iranians, and the Thais, because they at least work hard. So I think that's quite it's a good example of the irony involved in a racially determined, racially defined immigration policy. And to make matters worse, Nikkei-gene were permitted under the law not only to take up residence and take up employment in Japan for themselves, but they could also bring their spouse and children with them. Outmarriage amongst the Japanese Brazilians is over 50%, nearly as high as outmarriage amongst Japanese Americans. And so as a result, what entered in Japan entered into Japan in very large numbers. 15 years ago, there were less than 100 Brazilian Nikkei-gene in Japan. Today, there are nearly 300,000. But amongst these are not just the descendants of Japanese immigrants who left for Brazil at the beginning of the 20th century or immediately after the Pacific War, but their wives or husbands, many of whom are not of Japanese descent, and their children. So, as a direct result of a racially motivated immigration policy designed to prevent the emergence of foreign communities, the Japanese immigration and nationality law has had just the opposite effect. With nearly 300,000 Brazilian Nikkei-gene in Japan, who are not spread evenly across the country. There are pockets, usually in the provincial industrial towns, which now have to produce records in Portuguese as well as Japanese, special programs for Portuguese-speaking children in schools. There are now full-blown foreign communities developing as a result of this policy. So that's the Nikkei-gene. For the people of Okinawa, colonization and decolonization are not simply matters of the pre-war and the immediate post-war past. After all, Okinawa remained an American territory until 1972. And in the contemporary context, that is to say 2004, Okinawans confront a fluid present in which competing versions of an authentic Okinawan identity challenge a current colonial order dominated by the central government in Tokyo and the US military, whose network of bases exert enormous economic, social, and cultural influence throughout the Ryukyu Islands. In fact, 90% of the US military presence in Japan is located in the prefecture of Okinawa. In other words, Tokyo welcomes the US military presence but shunts it as far away from Tokyo as possible. Like their Korean counterparts, Chinese residents, approximately 220,000, including those who have become naturalized citizens, comprise a number of diasporan communities split between those who support Taiwan, those who support the PRC, but others can trace their origins as far back as the 17th century to what was known as the Tojin Yashiki, the Chinese commercial and residential quarter in Nagasaki. This brief sort of summary analysis of the construction of the Japanese self also leads me to consider the evolution of Japanese attitudes over time towards two populations, African Americans and Jews, whose historical presence in Japan has been extremely limited. Indeed, the impact that blacks and Jews have historically exercised on the development of Japanese racial attitudes has greatly exceeded their numbers in Japan. The disparaging remarks made by political leaders in Japan with reference to African Americans, coupled with advertising campaigns that deploy, that make use of racialized and infantilized stereotypes of blacks, have been evident in Japan for decades. They go back to the pre-war period. But in contrast to this, we have Japanese youth culture, which, paralleling its white counterpart in the United States, has drawn inspiration from and through the appropriation of African-American music, fashion, culture, and even language. Likewise, while small Jewish communities emerged in Japan during the Meiji period, in the port cities of Kobe and Yokohama, for example, the Jewish presence in Japan has been negligible. Nonetheless, elements of both Philo and anti-Semitism have been continuously present in Japan, extending from the late 19th century through the Pacific War years and up to the present. In the post-1945 context, Japanese ambivalence towards the Jews has been reflected in a fascination with and the commodification of Anne Frank, for example. Most visitors to the Anne Frank House in Amsterdam are in fact Japanese. And the diary of Anne Frank has gone through, at last count, 16 separate editions in Japan. Moreover, this is back in the late 1970s, a clever marketing executive in a Japanese pharmaceutical concern decided that he could market tampons making use of Anne Frank. And they were called, these tampons were called, this is, you know, this is taken from the package, Anne no hi. In other words, Anne's day, her day in the month. So while we have this fascination with and commodification of Anne Frank on the one hand, there has also been widespread publication and sale of virulently anti-Semitic materials on the other. The resilience of Japanese anti-Semitism in particular illustrates how a wholly imaginary presence may be signified as real, as a means of reinforcing notions of the Japanese pure self and the impure other. During the 1990s, if you went into any major bookstore in Tokyo, Osaka, Nagoya, or Kobe, there would be what was called in Japanese a Yudaya Kona, the Jewish or Jew corner. And there would be hundreds of books Now, some of these were legitimate in the sense that they were translations of the Old Testament. Others, however, carried titles like the 450-year conspiracy against Japan. If you want to know Japan, learn about the Jews. These books were, they might have been written by cranks, but they didn't sell in that way. They were bestsellers, and some of these sold copies in the millions. And so to conclude, the revisionist genius, and hence its popular appeal in contemporary Japan, has been to seize upon multiculturalism as a threat to Japanese exceptionalism, in other words, uniqueness. In their view, the true Japan, the pure Japan, the one that must be preserved, reflects essential and timeless truths agreed upon long ago by reasonable men. But their search for the grail of difference, for a uniquely sanctified past, masks disrespect for the real thing. To put it another way, the revisionist school in Japan worships at the shrine of history, but is ignorant of the historical method. How we think is not simply a consequence of what we have seen or felt in our own lives, nor can forms of thought and social behavior be reduced to a genetic shadow cast by our ancestors, our grandparents, and our parents. People look at, people apprise the world from within the ideological and cultural currents that surround them, even if the historical sources of these currents are not visible. In other words, you may not be interested in philosophy, but philosophy is certainly interested in you. If, therefore, the Japanese, like the rest of humanity, are to be defined by what has not yet occurred, is it so surprising that they have approached the new century, no, the new millennium, unsure of what it means to be Japanese? Alternative visions of a multicultural Japan, or a multicultural future for Japan, may be compelling, they may be frightening, but they are not a fait accompli. They are intrinsically ambiguous and therefore invite interpretation and reinterpretation. Thank you very much. Gunming has promised me that if you don't ask any questions, she'll ask questions that are prearranged.
Dr. Weiner, I'm just wondering what percentage of the population in Japan would you consider belonging to those marginal groups altogether?
That's a good question. In total, Japanese population is approximately 127 million. And depending on which data you accept, the minority populations put together represent about 5%. Just over 5% of the total population. And what most people tend to do on that basis is compare it with the United States. This is a tendency both amongst Americans and Japanese. If the Japanese want to compare themselves with the outside world, they only look to the United States. And as far as the United States is concerned, which is equally isolationist, the comparison is with Japan. So on that basis, one could, with some justification, argue that minorities really aren't much of an issue in Japan because it's only 5% of the population, whereas in the United States it's significantly higher. And in a state like California, what are called the gray people or the pink people, people who look like me, are now a minority. Okay? However, if we were to look globally in terms of industrialized or post-industrial states, Japan is about midway. In terms of the size of its minority population, it compares with Denmark, with Belgium. It's slightly less than Britain, which is about 8%, but more than Finland, Sweden, Iceland, not quite as much as France. So it's important, A, to think comparatively on the one hand, and also the fact that these minority populations are not spread equally across Japan. So it's not as if one in every 20 people you encounter is a member of a minority population. Demographically, there are areas of very high density. So if you were to visit certain small cities in Gunma Prefecture, which is north and slightly west in Japan, you will encounter towns where all the road signs are written in Japanese, of course English as well, or an anglicized version of Japanese in Romaji, and Portuguese. Likewise, and I've had this experience many times in Japan because of the work I do, people living in Tokyo will say, well, yeah, I mean, this burakumin problem, which numbers 3 million, yeah, that's big, but that's a problem in Osaka. That's a problem in Kyoto. We don't have any here, so I never learned about it. Well, in fact, there are burakumin communities just across the prefectural line in Chiba, next to Tokyo. But it is true that they're concentrated. If you walk through parts of Osaka, there are large areas that are primary centers of burakumin density. Likewise, if you walk out of the spanking new, well, 5 years ago it was spanking new, rail station in Kyoto, magnificent building. If you walk out, there in front of you is majestic Kyoto, with the shrines and the temples and the hills. It's wonderful. If, however, you turn left, walk to the corner, turn left again, and walk a quarter of a mile, you're in a different world. You're in one of the largest burakumin ghettos in Japan. So these groups tend to be concentrated in particular areas. The same with the Chinese. Very large concentrations in Yokohama and Kawasaki, early points of entry for European traders who brought their Chinese compradors with them, or people who came across during the 30s and 40s, either voluntarily or not, to work in Japanese war industries. Koreans, slightly different again. The largest concentrations of Koreans tend now to be found in the main island of Honshu, Osaka, Tokyo, Yokohama, Kawasaki. But up until 1940.
How the Japanese embraced as well as how that changed the Japanese culture as a whole since the war?
Well, that's a small question, isn't it? Yeah, 60 years worth. Okay. I'll go back a little bit further than that. And it's.
Could you rephrase the question?
Yeah, to look at the impact of North American, which is a really euphemistic way of saying the United States, because that place up north really doesn't have an impact anywhere, right? Yeah, the impact of US culture on Japan, particularly in the post-war period, and what have been the responses to that within Japan. This is an enormous question, which probably take days and quite a few bottles of whiskey to answer appropriately. The U.S. or the impact of U.S. culture cannot be overemphasized in the post-war period. Pre-war period, much less so, despite Tom Cruise's appearance in 1877 to teach the Japanese how to modernize. In the post-war period, the U.S. presence has been enormous, both literally and metaphorically. You have to bear in mind, A, that Japan was occupied for 7 years by the United States. It was referred to as an Allied occupation, but 99% of the troops involved were American servicemen and servicewomen. The post-war constitution, the so-called peace constitution, was written by a small group of young New Dealers between the end of the war and early 1946. The Japanese parliament was given the opportunity to draft a new constitution, but because the supreme commander of Allied forces, Douglas MacArthur, found it unacceptable, it was given over to a group of about a half a dozen new dealers in their early to mid-30s, and it was they who drafted the Japanese Constitution. So politically, right from the start. And of course, Japan has been and remains the most loyal ally of the United States in the post-1945 period, without any doubt. In fact, former Prime Minister Nakasone Yasuhiro, who I referred to before, he referred to Japan as the United States' floating battleship in the Pacific. So at a military level and at a political level, the ties are very strong indeed. I'm not finished with this one yet. At a cultural level, but you can put your hand down, I'll remember you there. At a cultural level, and here it's much more difficult to pin down, there is no doubt that the United States has had an overwhelming impact, particularly in the, say, 40, 45 years after 1945. American television, American cinema, American novels, American heroes, American heroines were incorporated within what was emerging as a post-war culture. How do people reflect upon that? How have they reflected upon it in Japan? It's very difficult to generalize, because if I did, I would risk essentializing Japan. There are 127 million Japanese, and each one has absorbed, assimilated, or rejected, and rejected, bits of American-inspired culture. But I'll risk a generalization. For quite a long period of time, the alliance with the United States was broadly accepted in Japan, at a political level, at a social level, at a cultural level, and at a military level. The United States was perceived not only as the only country to have ever defeated Japan in a war, but as a country, as the country that had saved Japan from the grip of the militarists. Now, this is a narrative, it's not necessarily true, but this is what was widely propagated and what was taught in the schools. And of course, US politicians did their very best to reaffirm that, or to reconfirm that. Since 1972, there have been changes. In 1972, I don't just pluck it out of the air, but because that was the year when, without any consultation with its primary military and economic ally, Richard Nixon took the United States off the gold standard and visited mainland China. This came as an enormous shock to the political and economic establishment in Japan. How could our ally treat us with such contempt? Now, it didn't necessarily mean an end to the alliance, but it did inject a level of suspicion, we say, that hadn't been there before. During the 1980s, now I wasn't here then, but I remember seeing photographs and reports on television of US congressmen destroying or beating up Japanese cars on the steps of the Capitol, right? As Japanese manufacturing began to not only compete successfully with, but assume pride of place by comparison with US manufactured goods, particularly home electronics, consumer electronics, automobiles, and so on. The US response generated great puzzlement in Japan, because as far as Japanese planners were aware, they had been doing what they had been told to do all along. It had been the United States that had encouraged Japan to erect very high tariff barriers and non-tariff barriers as a means of preserving and nurturing domestic industry. Any of you familiar with the term just in time?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh. Well, that's regarded as a Japanese invention. Well, it's not a Japanese invention. It was the brainchild of an American economist, Deming, who couldn't find anyone in the United States willing to listen to him. So he went to Japan. And it wasn't all Japanese executives who listened to him. It was the ones from Toyota. So here again was an example of what had been learned from its mentor, the United States. And of course, the United States very much enjoyed that role of mentor. How shall I put it without being too offensive? It fitted in rather neatly into the Orientalist and exotic notion of Japan and the Japanese as a country and a people whom we need not take too seriously. After all, they know their place in the world, and they're not really going to compete with us. So for the US in the 1980s, big shock. Suddenly the Japanese are not only competing, but they're buying Manhattan. This is not a good thing. More recently, and this is very much a generational thing, one finds that at a cultural level, the impact of the United States, I don't want to call it US culture because there ain't no such thing, but of the US remains very strong and very pervasive. But it's not the same US culture of the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. It is overwhelmingly, to a certain extent anyway, African American. In terms of music, in terms of fashion, in terms of language. And this, I think, represents something of a sea change. Because on the cultural side, there's great admiration. Young Japanese still, I think, look, if they're going to look beyond their own shores, to the United States. Paris Hilton and her sister, for example, are much bigger stars in Japan than they will ever be here. They market the Hilton sisters' handbags, their own perfumes, and when they arrive in Tokyo, it's bigger than when Madonna arrives. Right? So, now you may regard this as a good influence or a bad influence, I'm not going to say, but that at that level, which I think is significant, the influence remains important. But at a political level, things are shifting. And it's being shifted not necessarily by domestic developments, but by international developments. In survey after survey of the Japanese conducted over the last, 18 months, they, like the most other peoples in the world, have expressed overwhelming opposition to the war in Iraq. Overwhelming opposition to their government's agreement to provide assistance to the coalition of the willing in Iraq. Now, whether this will have long-term implications, I wouldn't like to speculate. At yet another level, disengagement from the United States is underway at a military or a geopolitical level. The demands for the rewriting of the post-war constitution, and in particular Article 9, which involves the projection of military power as a means of settling international disputes. The fact that that the Japanese government of today is prepared to send troops to Iraq. This would have been impossible 20 or 30 years ago. And I think that reflects the fact that in Japan, even amongst the old conservative elites, that the trust that they once had in the United States as its protector, that umbrella that would allow the Japanese corporation to happily go about its business of manufacturing, selling, and extracting resources, is no longer there. And that the big bear on the street now is much closer than the United States. It's China. So I think there is a shift taking place. But that's only to be expected, because attitudes are always shifting. Now, we don't find, you know, relationship between two peoples or two countries never remains immobile for very long. And I think this is also true of Japan and the United States. I think it's a very good thing. I think it's a very healthy thing, on the one hand, for there to be a disengagement from all things American, because there has been this tendency in Japan to think of the non-Asian world as the United States, A. And not really to go much beyond that. The West, because the Japanese are just as guilty as we are of thinking in these binary terms, East and West. There's no such thing as East. There's no such thing as Asia, for that matter. The people who live in that part of the world don't necessarily think of themselves as Asians. I don't think of myself as a Westerner. It simply doesn't function like that. So on the one hand, I think it's quite a good thing that Japan gradually disengages itself from the United States so it can begin to see the world in different ways. On the other hand, there is a danger that under pressure from the United States, and possibly from the PRC, the People's Republic of China, that we could see a more muscular and more assertive Japan, muscular in a military sense. I mean, Japan already has the third or fourth largest defense budget in the world, and it doesn't take a genius to envisage a day in which the Japanese military could be used, not necessarily in peacekeeping operations, because there are disputes going on all the time. There are disputes between Korea, both Koreas and Japan, over what the name of the sea is between the peninsula and the archipelago, and what the names are of the various islands. And there's a dispute going on between Taiwan, the People's Republic of China, and Japan over, I think it's the Spratly Islands. So there are plenty of potential flashpoints, and I haven't even mentioned North Korea, which Japan does not even recognize. So disengagement from the US, I think, is, on the whole, taking place, but it's very gradual. And I think, on the whole, it's a good thing, but there are dangers. I remember you.
Okay.
Do you remember your question?
I remember all of them.
Oh, more than one.
I don't want to be typically offended by the things I have to ask you, but the first thing I guess I have to ask is, you actually teach or?
Yeah.
Okay, in East Coast?
West Coast.
West Coast.
But I have taught on the East Coast as well.
Right. Then, when you teach on the West Coast, I wonder if you, I find it that all you have to offer so far are criticisms and not any solutions. I also find it, well, it's not even sad that you don't mention or that you take all the negative out of, you know, from Japan. I find it sad that, you know, foreigners and folks go to countries and if you remember to, you know, and they, what they come out with is all the negative. Yet you don't, you know, that you don't mention any great Chinese or not Japanese and Japanese Americans who have done things that, you know, you don't mention their religion, the, you know, great feminist movements that have occurred there, like you don't name anyone.
Well, if I could answer that question first.
You don't seem to acknowledge them at all. Okay. Maybe it's not in your field, but it's
Wait. That's not what the talk was about. That's why. Nor did I talk about sushi, because that's not what the talk was about. What I'm looking at, what I try to look at tonight, is the attempt by certain interlocking groups in Japan to rewrite history with the stated purpose of recreating a particular type of national identity in Japan. Now, if you find that offensive, I have no regrets, nor do I offer any apologies. And in terms of offering answers to what? I do not think that it is the role of scholars and teachers to offer answers and solutions. I think it's our responsibility to be provocative and to encourage our students and our listeners to challenge and to be critical. Answers I leave to politicians. They don't necessarily do a very good job, but it is their job. It is not my role as an academic, as a scholar, or as a teacher to offer solutions. I wasn't actually...
Solutions was the wrong word then. Maybe it's not within the field to theorize, but I don't find what you have to teach relevant if that's all, criticism is all you have to offer.
Well, I think I would suggest to you that you sit on other lectures I give on other topics, because depending on what I am addressing, it might be positive, it might be less negative, it might be more negative. It really depends on what I'm talking about.
You're not really talking about anything that I haven't heard before. I don't know about everyone else here, but I don't think it's new. I don't think these criticisms, have been documented. Other people better known.
Would you care to name a few?
I can't name any off the top of my head, but I know that these criticisms already have been documented and have been spoken about.
And what are these criticisms that I've made? Could you care to name those? Because you should be able to remember since I just spoke of them.
When you mentioned the Nanjing massacre, when you mentioned, that the Japanese, well, these aren't your words, but you basically said that they were snobs and ethnocentrists. But you criticize that about any country, and not only that, but you're taking a snobbish approach yourself. Those are two things.
Well, I regret the fact that you are dissatisfied. I would, however, point out that I've been working in this field for 25 years, and some of the work that you may be referring to is work that has been either written by me or my students, in some cases. So I don't know whether I am well known, better known, or unknown. I don't think I'm unknown.
My sources are older.
Older? Well, would you like to name a few?
I'm sorry. I can't name any off the top of my head, and I may not have the same credentials as you, but I have spoken to Japanese Americans as far back as the concentration camps in America.
Okay. But so that's not an issue that I was addressing.
Yes, but they know their history.
They know their history of what? Of what? The internment camps?
Further back as far as Japanese who come here.
And?
So.
And by virtue of the fact that they were Japanese.
My history research isn't finished. It's more not official. What would the word be? But I guess I just don't have the credentials yet.
Well, I wish you luck. Question back there?
Yes. You talked about identity, and I'm just wondering what is the connection of between the so-called pure Japanese identity and the Ainu, aboriginals. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think one of the things that I touch on, both explicitly and implicitly, is the absence of a Japanese identity. That if we assume or argue that there is such a thing as a Japanese identity, then we are ignoring the fact that diversity has always existed in Japan. In fact, I would argue that until 1869 really, there was no such thing as Japan. And if you were able to conduct a social survey or a questionnaire, say in the 1850s, walking through rural Japan, interviewing people in terms of identifying who they were, or them identifying for you, very few would have identified themselves as Japanese. So I certainly don't want to give the sense that there is such a thing, or has ever been such a thing, as a single Japanese identity on the one hand. The issue with the Ainu is curious in a number of respects. The Ainu are regarded as the inhabitants of Hokkaido, though at one time they did occupy a large part of northern Honshu. And of course, the Ainu themselves were not simply a single grouping, more along the lines of perhaps in North America, the Native Americans. Different tribal, and I don't use tribal in a pejorative sense, but they were tribal entities with some customs that overlapped, but their languages were quite distinct from one another, which was the case in the mainland of the mainland Japanese as well. The period of intense contact between the two groups can be dated back as early as the 9th, 10th centuries, as the Japanese began to expand north from the old heartland around Kyoto, forcing these people further north. Then it picks up again 17th and 18th centuries, when one of the feudal domains in Japan, Northern Honshu, established trading relations with certain southern Ainu populations. And things remained more or less on those lines until the Meiji Restoration, at which point the new Japanese state, the government, determined the necessity to incorporate Hokkaido into the new nation. And the reason for this was geopolitical, the threat from the north posed by the Russians. Policy towards the Ainu was assimilationist, was colonialist, in the sense that Ainu customs, the Ainu language, were both suppressed in the interest of inculcating the Ainu with a new sense of belonging to Japan, on the one hand, and the decimation of Ainu society and Ainu culture on the other, through a number of vehicles. Up until the time of the incorporation, most the sort of political economy of Hokkaido was hunter-gatherer and fishing. What the new Japanese state brought with them was an entirely new concept of land ownership. And so rather like in the American West, the new Meiji state took it upon itself to divide up the land of Hokkaido and make it available for settlement. Not by Ainu, necessarily, but by settlers coming from the Japanese mainland. Ainu were not excluded from the process, but, and here we, I suppose we get into an odd sort of form of affirmative action. All people who received land grants from the then colonial administration in Hokkaido were given a period of 10 years in which they had to build a house and demonstrate that they had produced agriculturally. Well, for the Japanese farming population that was moving north to settle, this did not present a particular problem because they brought the experience, the expertise, and the tools. For the Ainu, however, these were new technologies, new ideas of ownership, and so on. And so many Ainu actually lost their land as a result. There's also, on top of that, the issue of intermarriage, or I should say interbreeding, because a lot of the interbreeding that took place, rather like in the American West, was not voluntary, at least from an Ainu perspective. There was a lot of raping, systematic raping that was carried out by Japanese male settlers, who also brought with them new diseases that decimated Ainu populations. If I had to even try to put a precise figure on the size of the Ainu population in Japan today, pure Ainu, probably less than 30,000. And what is quite interesting to note, certainly since the 1970s, is amongst the younger Ainu, there has been a very serious and concerted attempt to revive Ainu culture, and in a sense to reimagine Ainu culture, because there wasn't a single Ainu culture, but something to distinguish them from the Japanese, but in a positive way. And so you can find courses now offered at colleges, and I think even at the University of Hokkaido, on the Ainu language, which was in danger of disappearing entirely. And with that, the introduction or reintroduction of, not, I suppose, the literature, but it's really the oral tradition of the Ainu, because they didn't have a written tradition, you know, the great sagas, but there were the storytelling traditions. And so I've been to research centers in Hokkaido where they are sitting down with elderly Ainu and simply recording these great stories and sagas and ballads of an Ainu past. Now, to what extent they're reproducing an accurate version of history, we don't know. But it is having an impact on the rejuvenation of an Ainu identity. It might not be the Ainu identity, but it's an Ainu identity.
Professor, I wonder, now, you as an academic professor in the Japanese history and all those things, tell me something, since 1980, why the society in Japan declined so much? Like, not maybe innovative way of explaining idea or anything, you know, why did it change so much?
When you say declined, you mean economically?
Military. Military. I mean, at that point in 1980, I mean, they have a very big ambition, almost like conquer the world and everything.
I don't know if it was their intention to conquer the world. Actually, things weren't too bad until 1989, 1990, when the bubble begins to burst. I'm not an economist. I think so. You know, bear that in mind.
Can I address that?
Well, I'll throw my bit out. I think it has a great deal to do with the way in which Japanese corporations did business with the banks and the overwhelming importance of land within the Japanese economy. So that rather than people investing in stocks, rather than investing in bonds, although the Japanese had and still have amongst the highest savings rates in the world, people would invest in land. And it became a speculator's paradise during the 1980s. Eventually, however, the bubble burst. And the bad loans that had been made. So for example, if you owned in 1980 a piece of land the size of this room in central Tokyo, you would be permitted to borrow tens of millions of dollars, which you could then invest in more land, which is what people tended to do. But those land values were highly inflated. And so once the panic set in, or once the realization set in, that the land really didn't have the productive value attached to it, the banks began to call in the loans. People couldn't pay the loans. Banks began to collapse. And it's been hundreds of banks have collapsed. And along with them, major securities firms like Yamaichi,
yes,
who had invested very heavily in land speculation as well. So that's, you know, my interpretation, but there may well be an economist in the back who can add more.
I am an economist, but just very quickly, my question is not on economy. My question is basically the Japanese, pure Japanese thing that you're talking about.
Pure self.
And then the one point that you made, that was very interesting to hear that. This is the first time I'm hearing it. I have done research with the Japanese management, economy, business, and so forth. I have never heard of anti-Semitism in Japan because I have known for years that the Japanese company worked very, very well with the New York bankers and the Jewish community and the Jewish leaders, Citibank, Sandy Weill, for example, right? And there's many, many others, hundreds of others. And then the Japanese have their own perception of they're the chosen from the, they're coming from the sun. And then the Jews are the chosen. So for the, those two nations, sorry, for the those two ethnic groups, they are both the chosen from the God. So I don't see why the Japanese would discriminate against the Jews. That's, I'm very surprised to hear that.
Well, I'm not suggesting that the Japanese necessarily discriminate.
Anti-Semitism.
Because there's really not anybody to discriminate against.
Okay, go ahead.
I mean, the size of a Jewish community in Japan has never been more than a few thousand.
Right.
At its height.
Right.
And this would have been during the Pacific War. And here, again, an irony.
But that was way back.
That was way back, but I remember during that war, the Japanese were in alliance with the Third Reich.
Right.
And yet throughout the war, the Japanese were not only permitting, but actually encouraging Jewish refugees from Eastern Europe.
That's what I mean.
To move to Shanghai, right. some of whom actually spent the war years in Kobe, for example. Right. I don't think that the anti-Semitism that keeps raising its head in Japan is necessarily about Jews.
Rather like anti-Asianism
in the United States.
Okay.
Or anti-black sentiment in the United States. It's more about, in the United States anyway, white fears. About the preservation of our society. So that's really what I'm getting at there, that the anti-Semitism in Japan cannot be about actual contact because there's so little.
They have so little contact with the Jews.
Yeah, it's simply another way, another vehicle for establishing that sense of Japanese exceptionalism.
I have a question. You said that this official who helped him devise the radio making and another of these historical events, and I know that the Chinese community has kind of, not only in China and Taiwan, but also overseas, has kind of demanded that the Japanese kind of retract these statements. In many ways, they're rewriting textbooks, and we know that they're comfortable, and they were comfortable in Korea, itself as the nation. It seems very curious because I know. For South Korea, they see America also as the savior, as the protector, and that their history is also premised on the colonization of their country by Japan. And if Japan rewrites its history, it's not only rewriting its history, but the history of the whole of Asia. I mean, they're growing Southeast Asia, they're forward to also American history, and also with the, when these revisions are rewriting, history and trying to create this sense of pure self, of pure monolithic culture that you refer to, it has implications not just on their history, but on world history.
Absolutely. And that's a very important point. But we have to bear in mind that all countries are constantly rewriting and revising national histories, A. And B, we have to ask the question, why? Is it for the sense of history, for the sake of history unto itself? I would argue no. History is taught so that this generation and the next generation will have a positive sense of what it means to be a member of this community. I think it's true in Japan, but it's also true in the United States. It's true in South Korea and elsewhere. In South Korean textbooks, South Korean history textbooks, for example, one would get the impression that all Koreans during the occupation, 1910 to 1945, were anti-Japanese and actively involved in the anti-Japanese struggle. Unfortunately, it's not true. In any colonial situation, there are indigenous people who cooperate with and make a great deal of money from the colonizing power. And Korea was no exception. Park Chung-hee was trained in the Kempeitai, the Japanese gendarmerie, during the war. The whole issue of the comfort women suddenly burst in the early 1990s. But for those of us who've been living and working in Japan, as early as 1974-75, I was buying books written in Japanese by Korean residents on the comfort women. So it's not as if it was unknown. But beginning in the 1990s, it's gotten a great deal more attention, and I think partly due to globalization, and partly due to the emerging new relationship between Japan and in particular the Republic of Korea. No longer older brother, younger brother, but much more equal. And what struck me again there was that with the issue of the comfort women, A, they were not all Korean. There were comfort women from the Philippines, from Thailand, Indonesia, Malaya, even the Dutch. More often than not, the face that conscripted the Korean comfort woman from her village in South Korea was a Korean face. Mm. The Japanese were the planners, but more often than not, not always, it would be a village headman who would have had his reasons. He might have had no, he might not have seen any way out. Or it might have been a Korean policeman, because most low-level policemen in the colonial police force were in fact Korean. But this conflicts with the post-war historical narrative of the Republic of Korea, where it was important to build a sense of nationalism based upon the anti-Japanese struggle. So,
also for Chinese history, you know, our history is based on this anti-Japanese conflict that, you know, that supposedly the communists and nationalists kind of, you know, fought together over the Japanese, and then after that, you know, conflict was over, then there was internal strife within the
nation. And one point is when I visited the Nanjing Memorial, and it's a gruesome place in some respects, walking through, looking at the photographs that were taken, that revisionists in Japan deny. They argue that these were doctored photographs. But what struck me was that the national group that visits the Nanjing Memorial most often, aside from Chinese school parties, Japanese. And as you come to the exit, or at least on the day I was there, there were masses of bouquets that had been sent from high schools, middle schools, and elementary schools in Japan who have twinned with schools in Nanjing. Now, I'm not suggesting that that's the answer, you know, that that explains away what happened or provides adequate redress or compensation for what the Japanese imperial forces did in Nanjing. But it does suggest something else happening as well.
Thank you.
I think you wanted to jump in.
You're
welcome.
Thank you.
And I'm sorry to cut to some of the questions, and maybe you can always email Professor Weiner.
You can.
I certainly learned a great deal, although I have listened to Professor Weiner.
Before.
A couple of times.
But not
enough. Not enough. Thank you so much.
Pleasure. Thank you.